Hi, welcome back. Welcome to Insect Systematics lecture series. We are discussing the general characters of orders and economically important families. So in the last lecture, we were discussing Hemiptera, its suborder and economically important families. So in this lecture, we'll be dealing with order Thysanoptera. They are commonly called thrips. Okay, so here we are, order Thysanoptera. So as kids growing up, probably you might have tried to keep the flower near the nose in order to enjoy the fragrance of flower. Okay, and your parents might have told not to keep the flower like that near the nose, as many of the insects like these thrips, which are usually yellowish and blackish, may enter your nose. Okay, so in this lecture, lecture number 11, I'll be dealing with Thysanoptera. They are commonly called thrips. Okay, so these Thysanoptera earned the name because they possess fringed wings. That means there will be hairs on these elongated rod-like or ribbon-like wings. Okay, so there will be rows of hairs present on the wings. That's how they got this name, Thysanoptera. So, and usually they are 0.5 to 5 mm in length. So, very rarely they exceed 1 mm. So, most of them measure about 0.5 mm or so. They are very minute, yellowish or blackish insects, in fact. And their head is narrow and conical shaped like this. Okay. And very important characteristic feature of Thysanoptera is that they possess asymmetrical type of mouth parts, which is rasping and sucking type. So rasping and sucking means with the presence of the three stylets, in fact, they just scratch the leaf surface and the whatever the ooze which comes out will be taken by the conical shaped mouth. Okay, so what happens here? There will be only three stylets, left maxilla, okay, and left mandible will be present, whereas in the right side, there will be only maxilla. That means right mandible is absent, which is very important characteristic feature of Thysanoptera. Okay, right mandible is absent as a result of that. Okay, so thrips mouth parts is called asymmetrical type of mouth part. Remember this point. And next character is front and hind wings are slender, rod-like with dense of fringes of long hairs. Okay, that's how they earned the name Thysanoptera. Tarsi is 1 to 2 segmented, each with a terminal protrusible vesicle, which is like eversible apical bladder, like a bladder type like this, okay, which is actually swells. And ends, they also earned the name called Physopoda. Physo means extended, okay, swollen leg, poda. Okay, so ends, thrips also called Physopoda. So that's actually because of this bladder-like swelling, which occurs in the terminal part of tarsi. Okay, bladder-like swelling. Coming to biology of thrips. So thrips are exoterygotan insects or hemimetabolous insects. They should have only three stages, egg, nymph, adult. Okay, but here in case of thrips, they undergo an extended metamorphosis in which final immature stage is quiescent, non-feeding and is called pupa. Okay, you can see here, eggs are usually inserted into the plant parts. Okay, first instar, second instar usually sucks the juice, whereas the propupa, third and fourth stages are non-feeding, especially the fourth stage, which is called pseudopupa, okay, which is actually non-feeding quiescent stage. So that means they in fact look like, okay, holometabolous insects with complete metamorphosis. But what happens? Why they are not actually placed under the holometabolan insect group? Okay, a close examination of the Thysanoptera pupa, however, reveals that it does not undergo any internal transformation. Okay, only reshaping of external parts occurs and genitalia starts developing. So that's why they are still placed under the hemimetabolan group. And hence, but this pupa is also observed. That's why they are in fact considered as a separate type of metamorphosis, which is called intermediate type of metamorphosis. Remember, we studied A metamorphosis, ME metamorphosis, and Volo metamorphosis. Okay, in between ME and Volo, there is a intermediate metamorphosis which is undergone by Thysanoptera thrips. Okay, so we also studied about hyper metamorphosis, wherein each larval instar undergo different structure. In fact, they are now found to have different structure. Coming to economic importance, many thrips are destructive pests of plants, especially grain crops, fruits, vegetables, and ornaments. Okay. You might have seen in case of onion like this, in case of chili, okay, upward curling occurs, which is a characteristic damage by the thrips. And wherever they lacerate, whitish patches occurs on the leaf surface. So that is a very characteristic damage symptom caused by the thrips. Okay. Feeding activities results in plant deformities, scarring, loss of yield, and in some cases, they also transmit deadly pathogens, plant pathogens like tospoviruses, Ehlers viruses. They are the serious viral diseases of crops which are exclusively transmitted by thrips. Okay, whereas few of the species are predatory. Okay, they also, some of these species are found to be beneficial by, you know, feeding on pests, mites, and also other small insects. So we'll find both beneficial as well as the harmful species of thrips. Okay, and especially very characteristically, we'll find the support curling when they lacerate the juice by staying between the leaf surface. Okay, so this type of upward curling occurs. So I was telling that they also transmit deadly, you know, plant viruses like, you know, tospoviruses and Ehlers virus. So watermelon bud necrosis virus, you can see buds actually start, you know, drying, leaf scarring. Okay, in case of groundnut, you'll find the groundnut bud necrosis virus. So it's also occurs on sunflowers. It's called sunflower bud necrosis virus, watermelon bud necrosis virus. So they're all transmitted by thrips. So coming to classification, it consists of two suborders, suborder Terebranchia and suborder Tubulifera. Okay, what are the distinguishing characters of these two suborders? So here, ovipositories are like, here in case, Tubulifera, ovipositories reduced or absent. Terminal abdominal segment of female is conical, and in case of male, it's actually bluntly rounded. Whereas in case of Tubulifera, last abdominal segment usually tubular in both the cases. So here you'll find the sexual dimorphism in case of Terebranchia, whereas same in case of both the sexes in Tubulifera. Wings carried side by side along the dorsum when at rest. Okay. Wings overlapping along the dorsum when at rest. So in both the cases, wings are found placed above the abdomen only, but they are not overlapping, or they may be overlapping. That's the distinguishing character. Four wings with at least one longitudinal vine, principal longitudinal vine, reaching the apex, reaching the end of the wing. Whereas in case of Tubulifera, either without vines or with a short median vine, which does not extend to wingtip. So I'll show these characters with the diagrams. So Terebranchia and Tubulifera, ovipositories saw-like, you can see here, it's saw-like. So that means this ovipositor is helpful in, you know, piercing the ovipositor into the plant parts and laying the eggs inside the leaf tissues. Okay, whereas in case of Tubulifera, ovipositor is reduced or absent. So that means, so what happens here in this case, the feeding activity itself results in formation of cracks and crevices because of the folding of the, you know, leaves. And there in the crevices, you know, the eggs are deposited. So they are not inserted into the plant tissues like Terebranchia will do. Terminal abdominal segment of female is conical, and female, in case of male, it is actually bluntly rounded. Whereas in case of Tubulifera, last abdominal segment of both the sexes are tubular. Okay, so that is, you can find these extended abdominal segments. So wings are carried side by side along the dorsum at rest. You can see here, they may be touching each other, but they are not overlapping. Okay, whereas in case of Tubulifera, the wings are overlapping. Okay. The next character is four wings with at least one longitudinal vine reaching the apex. You can see here the one vine which may reach us up to the apical portion of the wings. Whereas in case of Tubulifera, so wings may not have the wings, or even if the vine is there, it won't reach till the apex of the vine. So here in this case, you will not find any of the vine. Okay, so that's how we can differentiate Terebranchia and Tubulifera. So what are the economic important families? We'll take one family each under Terebranchia and Tubulifera. Okay, so there is a family called Thripidae. You can easily remember Thrips, Thripidae, which belongs to suborder Terebranchia, which consists of number of economically important pest species, and they are phytophagous in fact. Thrips tabaci, okay, which attacks honey and tobacco, beans, so many other crops. In fact, it is a very serious pest. Citothrips cardamomi, which occurs on cardamom. Stinkytothrips biformis, which occurs on rice. Franklinella shulgi, which occurs on sunflower, watermelon, and many other crops. In case of Pleothripidae, which is a family under Tubulifera, okay, Tubuliferans can be easily recognized with the help of tube-like terminal abdominal segments. So it includes Fungivorous, Predaceous, and Phytophagous thrips. One of the pest species, which is called Gynecothrips fugili, which occurs on ficus. Okay, so because of the feeding activity, you find this upward curling. Coming to habit and habitat of thrips, usually they are found on flowers, foliage, fruits, bark, fungi, and debris. Okay, you can find large number of thrips on flowers, especially. Okay, on rows, you can see because of the feeding activity leads to deformation of rows. So, which fetches very less price in the market or may not be suitable for marketing. A few species are predaceous, associated with mites as well as small insects. They act as predator. How do you collect and preserve the Thysanoptera? It is not like other insects which we discussed using the yarn net and all those things, sweeping net and all those things. So we require an vial consists of AGA solution. What is this AGA? So AGA means ethyl alcohol. 10 parts of 60% ethyl alcohol, 1 part of glycerin and 1 part of acetic acid. Okay, AGA, alcohol, glycerin and acetic acid. Okay, that needs to be mixed and properly kept in vial. And that can be used as collection and preserving agent. So this mixture helps to distend the body parts and keep the body parts supple and relaxed. Okay, if you pin that specimen, okay, like you do for other insects, it may not be useful for taxonomic identification. Okay, with the help of camel airbrush, you can directly wet the airbrush with the AGA solution and you can directly transmit to vial. Or else on the plant parts, so you can go for tapping the foliage or flowers like this, which actually falls on the white sheets, which can be directly transferred to AGA solution with the help of wet camel airbrush. Okay, so you can wet it by dipping the airbrush into the AGA solution into the vial and then tap it like this and then transfer to vial containing AGA solution. So that is the best way to collect and preserve the Thysanoptera. So we'll end with a few questions. Thrips have dash type of mouth parts. Okay, we know that right mandible is absent. Second question is, which mandible is absent in case of thrips? I gave the answer already. Identification characters of Thysanoptera, order level characters of Thysanoptera. Why thrips are called physopoda? Okay, difference between Terebranchia and Tubulifera suborders. What are the distinguishing characters of these two suborders of Thysanoptera? Okay, thank you very much. If there are any questions, you can email me or you can ask me over mail as well. Thank you very much.